I'm not, and everything, the time changes. I don't know whether I'm coming or going. And, but God's in charge, right?
Amen.
No, do you believe that? God is in charge. We are here obedient to God. We've prayed, we've asked for direction, and God's going to do his thing today. And if you all believe that, say amen.
Amen.
All right. I couldn't get my microphone to work right this morning, so I'm going to be using this. And that's okay. I used it for years, didn't I? Okay, so we're ready for the worship team, and we're going to get ready to praise the Lord together.
Please stand if you're able and worship the Almighty God. Thank you.
And our goal is $1,000 this year. And as you know, we take 3 mission offerings a year. We take Lottie Moon, Annie Armstrong, and the California State Missions offering. So you know what? We support missions. And by the way, we have always gone over our goals. We've never missed our goals. So that's a good thing too.
Amen.
So we've got a drama coming up on, what is that, the 24th?
Yes.
The 24th, 2 weeks from today. And it's going to be an Easter drama called Amazing Love. And I'm looking forward to that, and I know you are too. And then Palm Sunday, which is the same Sunday as the drama, we're having a dinner, and we'll be fellowshipping in here with Crossroads and the Hispanic Mission, and it's going to be a great day, a lot of fun. It's just going to be wonderful. So, ushers, come on up here. How many of you had a problem getting up this morning? Well, you're all either brave or lying. You know what? Praise God for daylight savings.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, thank you, Lord God, for giving us the gift of another day of life, Lord God. And I thank you for everyone that is here today, Lord God. And thank you for our church and our pastor. I pray, dear God, that you would bless our church. Bless all the people that enter through the doors, Lord God, and for the offering, Lord God, both the gift and the giver, Lord God. I pray for a special blessing upon you. And we thank you and ask all this in Jesus' name.
Everybody said amen.
Amen.
Chances are you'll find me.
were lost and without hope, for us you paid the price. So when I reach that city, I'll kneel before the throne. Chances are you'll find me, and I won't be alone.
Here we are.
You found me, dying in my sin. We pray for them and lift them up. Pray for Ukraine. Same story. We don't know what's going on over there from day to day. And, you know, we have to leave it in God's hands. Because frankly, I don't know what to say about it.
Amen.
Other than I want God's will.
Amen.
And then we want to pray for the USA. It's going to get tougher as the year goes by, as we have an election year. And I'm praying for God's direction. I'm praying that God will bless us and help us to know how to vote and what to do and where to go. And I praise Him and bless Him for that. So let's pray and let the Lord lead us. Father, we pray that indeed You will lead us. That's why we're here. Because as children, we don't even know how to go out or come in. And yet we know that You will lead us by the hand and show us the way. We are grateful for that. Father, we pray for our church. We pray that You will bless the people that are not here today for whatever reason, that You will send new people to come, that we will, that our fellowship will be enriched and loving and draw ever closer to Jesus. Father, we pray for especially these people that we've listed on this list who are sick. We pray for them, for Your healing hand to be upon them. And we give You praise and honor and glory, and we pray this prayer in the name of Jesus. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Incline Thine ear to us and grant us Thy peace. Everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. I think I forgot something. You know what I'm talking about. Okay, go ahead, Daniel.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood.
Read it and understand it together. It took me a long time to grasp this, and I'm not sure I fully grasp it now. But I'm going to share it because God has given me a message to share with you. So we're going to read partially through chapter 6, through 1 through 11, but we're going to stop in the middle. He reads, "These things I have spoken to you, so that you will not be led into sin. They will ban you from the synagogue. Yet an hour is coming for everyone who kills you to think that he is offering a service to God." Recall that the history here is that Jesus has been under threat of death. They've been after him. They hate him. They want to get rid of him. They want to destroy him. And he's telling his disciples that they are going to experience some of the same things. And we know now from history, looking back, that was true. "These things they will do because they have not known the Father nor me. But these things I have spoken to you, so that when their hour comes, you may remember that I told you of them. However, I did not say these things to you at the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me. And none of you asks me, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, grief has filled your heart." I want to stop there just a moment. He's mentioned in former chapters about the Holy Spirit. And he's getting ready to give more information about the Holy Spirit. And he says in verse 7, he says, "But I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage, that I am leaving. For I do not leave. If I do not leave, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you." So he talks about the Helper and how the plan is that when Jesus leaves, the Holy Spirit, that he refers to him as the Helper here, will come and be with us. One of the things that we I think sometimes take for granted. In the days when Jesus was walking the earth and he had his disciples, they were together and he was teaching them and helping them to understand some things. But when they were by themselves, they were somewhat lost. You recall what happened to some of them, like with Peter. When he, after Jesus was taken, remember he denied Jesus completely that night. Another of the disciples struggled. And so when Jesus was sharing with them about the Holy Spirit, or the Helper that was going to come, he knew that he would need the leadership of the Spirit of God. And of course, we know, because we're looking back on this, we know that on the day of Pentecost, after the resurrection of Jesus, some days later, that the Holy Spirit was poured out upon the church. And that was the beginning of a great adventure. And we've talked about that before. But anyway, I want to pick it back up. I'm going to read again, verse 8. "And he, when he comes, will convict the world regarding sin, righteousness, and judgment." Now, I want you to notice in verse 8, it says something that is very easy to miss. "But he, when he comes, will convict the world." The world. We are not of the world. And the people who have trusted Jesus as their Savior and Lord, and follow him and obey him, and pray to God using his name, we are not of the world either. The problem was coming, and Jesus knew it was coming, that the day when he would be crucified and resurrected, the Holy Spirit would be poured out. But the disciples and the apostles would be leading the church, and they would be seeking God's direction, the Holy Spirit's direction, to know what to do, what to say, where to go. And of course, most of the New Testament is about that. and about how God raised up certain people and used them to do his will throughout the known modern world. So when it says, and he, the Holy Spirit, when he comes, will convict the world, the world is what's left after we have received Christ. In other words, we who are believers look at everything differently than the world does. The world, as it's talked about here, doesn't even necessarily believe in God. I was listening to a program this morning on the way in that is a Christian program, and it was talking about how scientists believe that the world and people came into existence after millions of years of evolution. And they believe this. They teach this. And yet the Bible speaks of only 6,000 or 7,000 years that mankind was in existence and that God made this world. And I'm not going to argue that with you. I believe that we all tend to see things God's way. But the point of the matter is that when we are raptured, when we go to be with the Lord, and we've talked about this many times, the rest of the world is going to be left to him.
Amen.
And things are going to change more than we can imagine. Because the Holy Spirit will not be working within the church and within believers. The Holy Spirit will be doing these three things in the world. And it says, the Holy Spirit will convict the world of sin because they did not believe me. And regarding righteousness, because I am going to the Father and you will no longer be able to see me. And regarding judgment, because the ruler of this world has been judged. Who is the ruler of this world?
Satan.
We know that. But that does not mean that he's not hard at work in this world. He has not given up. And he is determined to take over this earth. And he's determined to declassify Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit as even important in our memories. And so when it says here that he will convict the world regarding sin, I want you to know that when I was a boy, I was convicted of my sin. My mom talked to me about being a sinner, that we needed the forgiveness of Jesus Christ, of God. And I realized that I was a sinner. And yet, sin from the perspective that I was viewing it as a little boy is not anything about what's being talked about here. Sin is the depravation in the world that pulls people away from God and makes God look like a myth or a fairy tale. And the conviction of that kind of sin is brought on in the world by Satan. People don't even know they are sinning. People don't even know or comprehend how they are disobeying God because they've gone on believing what they believe and they don't want to hear it. I cannot tell you or count the people that I have talked to trying to share Jesus with them or the gospel with them who said, you know, preacher, I'm sorry, I just don't want to hear it. I just don't want to hear it. Now, maybe you've never had that experience. I've had that experience a lot. Because I'm rather bold in talking to people about the Lord. And I had an experience yesterday, as a matter of fact. My construction company, has a job that we're doing. Well, we can only work on Saturdays at that job. Because of the people that live there. It's a house that's had some serious brain damage. So we can only work on Saturdays. So I had my boys over there, and we were working hard, and I wasn't working at all. I was just watching and telling them how to do certain things and getting supplies that they needed. Well, anyway, the man of the house, and there was two little kids. The wife was gone, and the two little kids are just the most precious things you ever saw. I think they're like maybe 3, 4, 5 years old. And the little boy thinks that I'm Batman's friend. And the little girl can't decide whether she wants to be a princess or Wonder Woman. And they are so sweet and so cute. And so I talk to them a lot, and they, you know, they're just fun to be around. But this man, we were sitting on the sofa just talking, and he brought up that him and his wife and family had started going to church a couple weeks ago. No, he said about 6 months ago, and they were still going. I said, oh, that's awesome. You probably don't know it, but I am a pastor of a church. He said, what? And I said, yes. And so we talked about church, and we talked about the things of God, talked about the Bible, and we had such a wonderful discussion, and he had so many questions, because he had never been in a position before where one-on-one he could ask questions that he didn't know about the Bible and about Jesus and about God. We must have talked an hour and a half, and it was wonderful. And I want to say that and encourage you, because when you have an opportunity to talk to somebody about Jesus or about God or about the church, don't shy away. If they want to say to you, hey, I don't want to talk about it, okay. But don't always assume that people don't want to talk about it, because everybody has a need in their heart for forgiveness.
Amen.
For love.
Amen.
For Jesus.
Amen.
Some of them feel it, they don't even know what it is. So, what this passage of Scripture is dealing with, it's not dealing with us. It's dealing with the people that are left after us. And the Bible teaches that they will be on their own for about 7 years without the Holy Spirit, without the church, without anybody to encourage them or help them. And as you know, if you know anything about Revelation, and I've taught about it several times, the Antichrist is going to come.
Amen.
And the bulk and majority of the people are going to follow the Antichrist. And he's going to take them away from God. But anyway, this passage of Scripture dealing with three subjects: sin, righteousness, and judgment. Now, we are familiar with those terms because they have affected our life. We have the righteousness of Christ. We are righteous before God today, not because we are righteous and we've done all the right things. It's because we have received Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and his righteousness has become our righteousness. We don't have to worry about judgment anymore, because Jesus paid the price and was judged on the cross for our sin. So you see, these three words are pertinent to us. But we see them in a different perspective. We see them as things that have already taken place in our life by the power of the Holy Spirit and by the promise and power of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. So when I pointed out that this is happening in the world, understand and keep that perspective. For example, it's already said regarding sin, because they do not believe me. Think about it. When the church is removed, the words and preaching and scripture of Jesus is going to cease. And then it says, and regarding righteousness, because I am going to the Father and you no longer are going to see. But even though we can't see Jesus, we know that his righteousness is our righteousness, And the only hope for the world to experience righteousness is to see their sin and accept their sin and ask forgiveness and receive Jesus. And then finally, it talks about judgment. And it takes a very interesting turn here. And I have to admit to you, I do not fully understand it. And I've been studying this for years, trying to grasp. But the last thing it says, and regarding righteousness, because I am going to the Father, and you no longer are going to see me. And regarding judgment, because the ruler of this world has been judged. Now that's true. How did Satan get to be on this earth? Do you remember? Do you understand? Most of you do. It all happened because Satan led a third of the angels in heaven against Michael and the rest of the angels, trying to usurp the power of God and take over heaven. Of course, Michael won with his angels and the power of God, and Satan and his angels, which is estimated at about one-third of all the angels, were thrown down to earth. Earth was given to Satan as his place. Now, God created man and began to develop creation here. And you recall that Adam and Eve were sinless, but then they experienced sin when they sinned against God. And their entire life changed. The entire human race changed. And everything began going in the direction of the things that Satan would lead them in. In fact, when you really think about it, you know, when Noah built the ark and the flood came, the reason, do you remember the reason that happened?
Amen.
The world had become so depraved and sinful that God had to destroy the world. And he destroyed it with a flood. And there were only 8 people who were saved from that. Noah, his wife, and his 3 sons and their wives. Everyone else perished. Now you can say that's a fairy tale if you want to. I preached a sermon here one Sunday a few years ago. And I showed you pictures of Noah's Ark. Because it still exists today on Mount Ararat. And it has broken in half, and a glacier has pulled the bottom half down. But there are numerous pictures of the ark. And you know what, as far as I'm concerned, if I don't have any other proof of God's word, that's enough.
Amen.
That's enough. So there we see signs all over the world that God has been working and that God loves us and that he has not given up on us. But what he's doing here, he is illustrating what's left when we leave this earth, and that it's going to be a difficult time because people are going to have to face their sin when they don't even realize they have sin. People are going to wonder about righteousness when they don't think they need righteousness. And people are going to wonder about judgment when they don't even know it's coming.
Amen.
That is a horrible way to have to live. So anyway, it goes on from there. And we start talking about each one in particular. First of all, we talk about sin. I've already talked about sin a little bit. But apart from the Spirit's conviction, non-believers are unable to see themselves as sinners. How do we see ourselves as sinners? Because the Holy Spirit has revealed that to us. And I'm going to read another scripture in a minute that's very interesting about that. But it makes no difference if we come to Jesus as little children or as adults. Think about it. When we come to Jesus, when I was a little boy, I came to Jesus as a naughty little boy. I didn't know anything beyond that. Sometimes I told lies, sometimes I did bad things, But from a little boy's perspective, that's a whole lot different than the sin that takes place today with men and women. Because coming to Jesus as a naughty little boy and girl is a whole lot different than a man with a gun that robs a bank and kills a teller.
Amen.
And you know that. And we see that. But sin is sin. And people today and now who come to Jesus and ask forgiveness of sin, they will be forgiven of their sin. And they will receive the righteousness of God. And they will not have to go through judgment. But that's not who Jesus is talking about here. There's a scripture in Romans chapter 3, verse 23 that says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." If you've not heard that once, you've heard that 1,000 times. In fact, that's one of Billy Graham's favorite verses. We know that we have been sinners. First John, listen to this. I love this scripture. 1 John chapter 1, verse 8. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. You mean we are still sinners?
Amen.
Yep. But we are forgiven. We are forgiven. Because when we received Jesus Christ, he forgave us of all of our sins. And we live in a sinful world, but God has set aside for eternity in heaven. Another scripture, James 4:17. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin to them. Preachers talk about the sin of commission and the sin of omission. The sin of commission is when you do something wrong. The sin of omission is when you know you should do something that God wants you to do and you don't do it. That is sin. But we are even forgiven for that sin. All of our sin. Good, bad, black, green, red. It comes to Jesus and we are forgiven by his shed blood. One more. Romans chapter 6, verse 23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord." That's our promise. But that's not the promise of the world after the church age is over. And then finally, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1, "And you were dead in your trespasses and your sin." We were all dead in our trespasses and our sin until we came to Jesus. Until we ask Jesus into our heart to forgive us of our sins. Until we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Until God began directing our lives. So sin that we have looked at in our life is going to be looked at differently during the time after the rapture, during that 7 years of tribulation. They will not have a point of reference like we have a point of reference. But I can tell you one thing. If we've done our job, there's going to be some people that are going to say, "Oh my goodness, I remember what Grandma used to say. She told me that the rapture was going to come. She told me about forgiveness. Or my mom and dad went to church and I never liked to go. I never went." Or, you know, all the people that have been affected from what people, Christians and believers have said during that time. And when we are gone, they're going to remember those things. The next thing that it talks about is righteousness. Righteousness. I don't know how you feel, but I don't feel a bit righteous. I know my flesh. I know the mistakes I make. And if it were not for the grace of God, I would bust hell wide open. But my righteousness comes from Jesus. Because he paid the price for me not having righteousness because of my sin. And he paid the price for sin, which made me righteous under the blood of Jesus Christ. The world cannot know or understand righteousness apart from Jesus' sacrifice on Calvary. Righteousness is only available apart from sin. And Jesus substituted his righteousness for the world, but the sinner or the unsaved cannot grasp righteousness except Jesus on the cross. So that's why righteousness escapes the world apart from Jesus and the Holy Spirit. Here's some verses that deal with that in Scripture. First Peter chapter 3, verse 18 says, "For Christ also suffered for sin once and for all, the just for the unjust, so that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit." We know all of that, and we have embraced that as believers. Philippians chapter 3, verse 9 says, "And righteousness may be found in him," Jesus, "not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith." That's how I know that I'm righteous before God and that you are righteous before God, because of our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. He has given us his righteousness. The world will not have that righteousness. They will be totally depraved. Let me talk about judgment. And here's where I lose my way, because I don't quite understand. Jesus was speaking of the defeat of Satan when he talked about judgment. The cross defeated him because he thought Jesus was dead. But he arose, and the judgment of Christ on the cross has turned into our victory. But it turned into Satan's defeat. Do you see that? Satan knew that when he saw Jesus die on the cross, he thought, "Wow, that's just what I've been waiting for." The problem was, 3 days later, he rose from the grave, and he was alive again. And that ended Satan's reign of terror. But his terror doesn't end until a certain time. And we are waiting for that time to come right now. Let me read a passage of Scripture to you. Two or three of them, from John chapter 12. We've already read this in our study. "Now judgment is upon the world now. The ruler of this world will be cast out. Romans chapter 16, verse 29. "The God of peace will soon crush Satan under his feet. The grace of our Lord Jesus will be with you." Now, here's a scripture that really brings up some room for thought and clarification and understanding. It's found in Revelation. And we learn more about Satan in Revelation than any other book. But it says in chapter 20, verse 7, it begins, "Now when the 1,000 years are finished," the 1,000 years, "when the church is raptured, Jesus comes again. And a great battle ensues on earth. And the Bible said there will be a new heaven and a new earth. And that Jesus will reign on earth for 1,000 years. The Bible speaks of it as the millennium. And it's 1,000 years of peace with no sin, with no temptation, a time of peace under the reign of Jesus on earth. And so in Revelation, it talks about how Satan has been cast into the fiery furnace. No, the abyss. He's cast into the lake of fire after this. But at this point, he's put in by Jesus. He's put into the great abyss. Okay? Satan will be released from his prison at the end of the 1,000 years, at the end of the millennium, and will go out to deceive the nations from the four corners of the earth. In other words, Satan is released one more time. It's almost like God is giving Earth another chance to ignore and step away from Satan and not follow him like they had before. But it says that Gog and Magog will bring them together for the battle. They are as numerous as the grains of sand of the sea. They went up on the broad plain of the earth and encircled the camp of the saints and the beloved city. But fire came down from heaven and devoured them completely. There's some things about that I don't fully understand, but I've come to believe that there is going to be a millennium, 1,000 years of peace. I've come to believe that there is going to be a new heaven and a new earth. I've come to believe that God is going to bring a new Jerusalem, and that we are going to be coming and going out of the new Jerusalem and out of heaven. But at the end of that 1,000 years, Satan has one more chance at us. And Jesus ends it with the armies of God. The sin of our souls was the troubled Christian soul. And when he undertook to redeem and save us, and to make his soul an offering, Jesus, for our sin, the Lord Jesus undertook to satisfy God's injured honor, and he did it by humbling himself. We read in the New Testament of the days before Jesus was to die on Calvary, that he would sneak away to the Garden of Gethsemane and pray. In fact, you recall when he prayed so hard, he sweat droplets of blood, that he did not want to go to the cross, that he did not want to die, but he wanted to do exactly what his Father had intended for him to do. And he did it by humbling himself. I believe that when Jesus was being hung on the cross, he could have said the word and called 10,000 angels to come down and lay that place waste. But he chose to die there for you and me. So when he died at the cross and broke the power of sin and cast out Satan as a deceiver, Christ, reconciling the word to God by the merit of his death, broke the power of death and cast out Satan as a destroyer. In other words, he stripped Satan of his power. Now, we tend to think of Satan today as being around, tempting us, trying to harass us, trying to make us make mistakes, and it's true. I feel like I fight Satan every day. I don't know how you feel, but I feel he's always there trying to tempt me away, trying to pull me away, trying to whisper in my ear something that I know is ungodly or untrue. But Jesus is going to deal with that. And I just believe that Jesus is going to. I believe what the word says. But sometimes the word is difficult to understand. And we need to pray that God will give us understanding. That God will help us to know what to do, when to do it, how to do it. And so when we read a passage of Scripture, the Holy Spirit has convicted the world regarding sin and righteousness and judgment, and the believer will be with God forever. I don't know what it's going to be like to be with God forever. Think about our lives today. You think they're going to be anything like they're going to be in heaven? Like, if my wife and I decide that we want to go out to dinner, we jump in the car or my truck, and we go out to dinner. And guess what we have on the way home? Dairy Queen. Because that's how we think these days. If we want to watch something on TV, we'll watch it. If we want to read a book, we'll read it. Folks, I doubt very much that there's going to be a Dairy Queen in heaven. I doubt very much that there's going to be books to read in heaven. But somehow, I believe in my heart that God will have heaven more than anything we ever imagined here on earth.
Amen.
That will bless us and fulfill us and excite us and give us everything we ever thought that we wanted and more. I don't understand it. I read a book one time, not long ago, and they even made a movie out of this book. It's called Heaven Is For Real. Anybody heard of that?
Amen.
Yeah, really good book. It's about a little boy around 5 years old. And his daddy was a Methodist minister. And this little boy, they went on vacation. And this little boy had an appendix attack. And his appendix burst. And they were out traveling in the car, so they had to find a hospital and go to the hospital and, you know, get him taken care of. And so the daddy, the minister, the father, and he was an only child, this little boy. His daddy went to the chapel. And, you know, most hospitals have a chapel. And he went there to pray. And his son made it through the surgery and lived. So one day, weeks later, they were driving in the car. Now, I don't know if you remember days like that, like this. When I was a little bitty boy, and we were driving in the car, I'd be in the back seat standing on the hump, reaching, leaning on the front seat.
Amen.
You remember doing that?
Amen.
Oh, try that today. Highway Patrol will have a new idea for you. My sisters did that because things were different then. And this book talks about this little boy was in the back seat, leaning over the front seat, and his mom and dad were listening to the radio to the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. And his mother mentions that, wow, they can really sing, can't they? Isn't that music beautiful? And the little boy in the back seat says, oh, the angels sing a whole lot better than that. And they looked at him, and he said, well, when did you hear the angels sing? He said, well, when I was with Papa in heaven. And they said, what? And they didn't know what to do or what to say. They began questioning, but, you know, he was interested in other things. Later, he was talking, and his dad couldn't get out of it in his head. You saw Papa in heaven? And he said, yeah. And he said, just a minute. And he went and got a picture of his dad. Now, his dad was an old man when this picture was taken. Little boy had never seen Papa as an old man like that. And so he shows the picture to the son. He says, oh, no, that's not Papa. Because when we go to heaven, we don't stay old, the Bible says. And so he said, no, that wasn't Papa. Papa was a lot younger than that. So his dad remembers, hey, I've got a picture of my mom and dad when they got married. So he goes and gets that picture, brings it to the little boy and says, is this Papa? Oh, that's Papa. Yeah, he's the one I saw in heaven. I saw him when I was sitting on Jesus' lap. And his dad said, what? And it went on, and he says, I also met my sister, and he was an only child, because he never had been told that his mother had had a miscarriage when his daughter was about 7 or 8 months term, and the child died. Little boy had no way of knowing that. His mom and dad had never told him. But he saw his sister in heaven. And his mom quickly said, what was her name? What was her name? He said, you know, I don't think she had a name. Now, I don't know what that means. Maybe they're going to name her when they get to heaven. But do you see what I'm saying? There has been enough things in our lifetime that have been testified about, that have been in books and people talking about how they've had some moments in heaven and been taken to heaven and like that. And you've heard other stories about that. This little story about this little boy was the most amazing thing that I'd ever heard. Now, it didn't convince me that there was a heaven. I already knew there was a heaven. But it helped me experience some things that I had not experienced. So folks, here we are today. I believe that every person here today is a believer. I know most of you about as well as I can know anybody. And I love you all, and we love each other, and we love the Lord. But when we go to be with the Lord, the world is going to be full of sinners when the rapture occurs. You may not believe in the rapture. Okay, I understand. A lot of people don't. I do. I believe the Bible teaches about it. When that happens, the Christians are going to be gone. The church is going to be gone. It's going to be over as far as the Spirit of God on earth goes. And the Spirit will only deal with them, convicting them of sin, righteousness, and judgment, in the hopes that they will change their mind and remember what they had heard about Jesus. Let's bow our heads together, shall we? I hope that you have found something in all of this to give you some thoughts about and to pursue in your thoughts. But it all boils down to this. God has a plan for each one of us. Jesus paid the price for your sin and for my sin at Calvary. And when he raised on the third day, when he arose, it gave all of us victory over death. The Bible says that when we die, we are heaven bound. I don't know what's on your mind right now. You may be thinking of some things in your own life. You may be thinking of some people that you know or some family that you know that's not saved. Pray for them right now. Whoever they are, wherever they are. And pray that God will touch their heart and save them, and that they will experience the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. Special prayer today for anything. Anything at all. Raise your hand and I'll pray for you. I see you. I see you. I see you. Heavenly Father, see the hands that were raised and whatever need they have, God. Whatever issue they have, whatever they're seeking, Father, I pray that you will touch them and bless them and reveal truth to them that they need. And for all of us here today that sit in this place, that worship in this place, I pray, oh God, that you will give us direction in our life, that we will never forget that we belong to you, that we are your children. Would you stand, please? And I live my voice to worship you, O my soul. Rejoice, take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, worship you, O my soul. Everybody said, God bless you folks. Have a great day.